sun rose upon Jacob as he passed Penuel, limping because of his hip. This past Thursday, I had the honor of meeting the Right Reverend Griselda Delgado del Carpio, who serves currently as the Episcopal Bishop of Cuba. She is a remarkable woman leading a remarkable church. Originally, she was from Bolivia. And then she moved to Cuba in the early 1980s to study theology there at the Evangelical Theological Seminary in Matanzas. And this is a seminary that was co-founded by us, our Episcopal Church, right after World War II. And after she was ordained, she was sent out to work in a small, dilapidated church in a rural town on the north coast of Cuba. And when she got there, as, you know, new kind of ambitious clerics are wont to do, she wanted to fix up her church. So she asked around and she learned that, oh, there's a lumber yard about 5 kilometers away. And if you know anything about Cuba, or you can imagine, cars, especially private cars, are extremely expensive. And so transportation is not very easy. So she decided, I'll walk the 5 kilometers. It's not a tremendously long distance. And so she walked there, and then when she got to the lumber yard, she introduced herself. I'm the new priest at the, you know, church at the town over, trying to rebuild my church. Would you give me some lumber? And they said, no. And she said, no, you don't understand. I'm happy to buy it. I don't expect you to give it to me as charity. You know, what is the price? I'd like to buy some lumber. And they said, no, we're not going to sell you any lumber. And so she turned around and walked back the 5 kilometers back home. And then so next week, a week later, she did the same thing. She started walking 5 kilometers, lumber yard. I'm here to buy some lumber to repair my church. How much does it cost? May I buy some? And they said, no, we're not going to sell you any lumber. And so she went back home. And then next week, same thing. And she did this every week for 10 years. And at the end of these 10 years, finally, I think, like the judge in the story today from the gospel, they just got sick of her asking, probably, and they finally said, sure, yes, we will sell you some lumber so you can repair your poor little dilapidated church. And I think this story is a great example of the kind of perseverance that Jesus is talking about in our gospel story today. But honestly, this gospel story also, and Bishop Delgado's story, sort of leaves me with a problem. Because if I'm honest with you, I'm pretty sure I would not have done, could not do, would not be able to do what she did for that long. And I think if you're honest, I'm pretty sure most of you wouldn't have been able to do it either. And so my question today is, what is the source of our strength as Christians? What is the source of the bishop's strength? And what was the source of that widow's strength to keep going and asking over and over again? And when we look at the life of Jacob in our first reading, we see that it provides one answer to this question. Because the source of Jacob's strength, as in his story, was really his own cunning, his own intelligence, and really, if we're honest, his own sort of shameless ability to lie. Because before we get to the story of Jacob today, wrestling, a kind of odd story, we have to remember what happened to Jacob earlier. And what happened to Jacob earlier is not really a nice story, at least as it reflects to Jacob. As you may know, and if you don't, I'm happy to briefly tell you, Jacob had an older brother, Esau, and the first thing we see about Jacob is his older brother comes in from the hunt, and his older brother is very hungry, and he says, Jacob, I see you're making some lentil stew, may I have some? And Jacob says, no. He says, well, I'm really, really hungry. I'm going to die. Could you please give me some food? He said, sure, okay, I'll give you some food, but you have to sell me your birthright. And so Esau says, well, if I die, I'm worthless, so okay, fine, done. And then, you know, right as their father is dying, as their father says, you know, call to me Esau, the oldest son. I need to bless him. I'm dying. I need to pass on the tradition through him. And his mother and Jacob overhear this, and they say, okay, now is the time. And so when Isaac calls for Esau, Jacob comes in and says, oh, I am the oldest son. I'm the oldest son. Bless me, bless me. And the father says, you don't really sound like him. You know, are you really him? He says, yes, it's me, it's me. Come, please give me your blessing. And Jacob goes to such a far extent in terms of his lying as he kills some animals, and his brother was hairy, so he puts on some animal skin. When the father says, please come closer so I can make sure by feeling you. So he's feeling the animal skin. And then so Isaac gives Jacob the blessing. And then Jacob has to run away now, because his older brother, understandably, is extremely angry, wants to kill him. And so he goes into exile. And while in exile, living with his uncle, he continues his sort of cunning, kind of intelligent way of getting ahead. He starts to sort of fool around with paint and sort of animals. And his flock basically begins to grow and grow and grow. And he also gets a little taste of his own medicine, because Jacob wants to marry Laban, his uncle's sort of second daughter, Rachel. He said, I'd like to marry Rachel. He said, okay, fine, you know, work with me for 7 years and I'll give you Rachel. And then the wedding night comes and morning happens and oh, it's not Rachel, it's the older sister, Leah. And there's a wonderful rabbinic kind of anecdote where the rabbis are commenting on this story and they say, you know, Jacob is very angry in the morning. He says, all night I was calling to you, I was calling Rachel, Rachel, and you, Leah, said, yes, yes, you are a liar. And she says to him, yes, but when your father was calling Esau, Esau, you said yes, yes. So I'm just doing what you did. Mic drop, you know. Just a hint, if you're married or in a long-term relationship, at that point you say, okay, I'm sorry, you win. So what has all this gotten Jacob? So now we're at the end of this story, and he's now going back home. After many years away, he's got, you know, two wives and two concubines and huge family, all these flocks, but he's got kind of an angry father-in-law behind him. And ahead of him now, he's going to meet Esau, of whom he is rightfully very afraid. And so in the middle of the night, right before this big meeting, the greatest sort of crisis of his life, he has this wrestling match. Now, who is he wrestling with? Unclear, you know, maybe Esau, kind of a shadow, maybe his conscience, an angel, God. But clearly now, by Jacob relying on all of his cunning and intelligence and his shamelessness, he has gotten a lot. Let's not pretend this worked. But it also led him to this point of extreme crisis, such that now he is wrestling for his life with this greater being. And what happens in this wrestling match? And what happens is the turn that finally does get Jacob to realize where his true strength comes from. And that is, even though the story says, yes, Jacob sort of wrestled God or this angel to kind of evenly, not really. I mean, when the angel says, oh, you sort of prevailed against me, it's ironic, because right before that happened, the angel wounds Jacob so badly that he now has to limp for the rest of his life. So he wounds him and says, oh, you've prevailed, but now I will give you a blessing. And it is in that wounding that Jacob then now realizes, oh, I've been doing this wrong my whole life. My whole life I was relying on my cunning, my intelligence, my shamelessness. But now that I have this wound in my side and all I can do is limp, I now realize I have to rely on God's strength, not on my own. And this sort of points to, gives a hint of where we in the church as Christians find our strength. We find our strength in the wound, in the weakness that causes us to limp. As St. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians, the Lord tells to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And so we can apply this now to the Episcopal Church in Cuba. Its wound, it's limping. Because since the revolution in 1959, the work of the church in Cuba was strictly limited by the government. They were only allowed to celebrate the sacraments. Because the government said that our revolution will fulfill not only the material needs of all the Cuban people, but also the spiritual needs. And so atheism was the declared official religion, if you will, of the Cuban state. And if you openly practiced religion in the public square, you were then sent to detention camps. So for a whole generation or two, the Cuban church lost just all of its clergy and its people. The Cuban church at one point was actually part of the Episcopal church back at the turn of the 20th century. But a further wound happened to it. So after the revolution and all these changes, our church kind of unilaterally told them, we are now going to separate ourselves from you, you know, and now you will become an autonomous, independent province. Good luck. And so that was another wound. And so when you think of this image of Bishop Griselda walking 5 kilometers every week for 10 years, she's not just walking in strength on behalf of a strong institutional church. She's limping. But that is where her strength comes from. Her strength, the power of her faith, comes from the fact that they have nothing, that they are in exile, that even their partners, the American Episcopal Church, abandoned them. And through all of that, she found her strength. So for us now, what would it mean for us to be wounded, to walk with a limp? Now, it's not news that our reconciliation with Cuba, recently the Episcopal Church nationally declared that we were going to re-invite them back, and so now the Episcopal Church of Cuba is now going to be part of the Episcopal Church of America. They'll be part of Province 2, which includes New York, and as this congregation here starts thinking about global mission, I think Cuba could be a very interesting destination, especially since the cathedral in Havana does not currently have a partner institution. But we know that currently under this administration, right, these warming relations have now taken a step back. And so what would it mean for us to walk with a limp these days? I heard from someone recently who said, you know, I'm so angry at this president for all the things that he's done, you know, around the Cuba thing, around all this stuff, and I can't even say his name. It like cuts me. It wounds me. It cuts me to say his name. And so maybe what it means for us to walk with a limp is praying for the president by name. If that's you, you know, you hate this man so much that you can't even say his name, it wounds you, then maybe that's how you walk with a limp. You need to pray for him by name. And if that's easy for you and you're finally like, finally someone in this church is going to say something nice about our president, then maybe it's your turn to pray for the Speaker of the House by name. Maybe that's how you walk with a limp. And you know, if you keep doing this, there's a great evangelical Church of England priest, John Stott, and he once said, if you pray for someone, it is impossible not to start loving them. And so if you walk down this journey with a limp, just warning you now, you might start loving these two people. And what would that look like? What kind of world would that be if we started loving our enemy?